About 8 years ago, I was approached by Arun Singh from India, but now working in Ohio, near Kivela, to write an editorial for the British Journal of Ophthalmology, because Arun had published in a particular issue 3 papers about the epidemiology of retinoblastoma. He asked me to write a comment on that. And I thought for a while, what could I write that people might be interested about? And I took the idea of trying to calculate how many retinoblastomas every year are diagnosed in the whole world compared with how many uveal melanomas are diagnosed. And as a surprise to me, I found out that there most likely are more retinoblastomas in the world than there are uveal melanomas. And that forms the basic of these calculations. And a little later, I had a fellow from the International Council of Ophthalmology coming from Uzbekistan for 3 months in Helsinki. And then with Dr. Usmanov from Uzbekistan, we extended this by trying to calculate for every country how many retinoblastomas there should be. And this is not a big issue for many countries in Europe, because we have a very accurate cancer register that can capture every child in the population. But that is not true of Africa and some other parts of the world. And if you don't have a cancer registry that registers every child with retinoblastoma, you can start with the theoretical calculation. And this is how the numbers are made in this talk. So I think that if you read a typical paper about retinoblastoma, they tell you that, and I think everybody agrees with this, it's the most common cancer of the eye in children. But they also say it's a rare disease. And certainly for any ocular colonist in China or India, it's not a rare disease. So I'd say that today we can say it's not only the most common eye cancer in the children, it's also the most common eye cancer taking all ages together if we look at the whole world. And that's why it really needs our attention. And luckily, we are able to cure retinoblastoma much better than we are able to cure uveal melanoma. I'll talk to you tomorrow more about the statistics, but suffice it to say here that if you look at the incidence of retinoblastoma per live birth and look on which year a particular child was born, we get a very flat incident rate. Oops. Unlike in many other cancers, there is no increase, there is no decrease. It's absolutely flat in Scandinavia from 1955 to today. And it's the same.
Side with for
the oh. One should be very careful. And if you take the average from here, you will get one retinoblastoma in 16,600 live births. And this is what we use with Dr. Usmanov for the whole world, because I really think that there is no evidence that retinoblastoma would be more common in any country in the world. We have papers from Africa, we have papers from some Asian countries that say that we have more retinoblastomas per population, but they are based on a few years and a small sample, and then you get the random variation. You see the random variation here is from 1 case to 10 cases in Finland. And if you only take a few years, you can get the wrong idea. If you take a long distance, then I think in every country in the world, it should be 16,640 on average. And when we did these calculations, we were able to test them with the data from Japan, thanks to Dr. Shigeru Suzuki, who provided us some of the evidence that was not yet published. The line that we have here is the theoretical number of retinoblastomas in Japan based on WHO world population prospects, the historical record, and what they predict that would happen until 2050, with the 95% confidence interval. And the boxes here are the actual Japanese data. They started their register in 1970. And you will see that there is variation from year to year. And the dotted line is the statistical average of the Japanese record. And you see that initially they went on the lower 95% confidence interval. But when we come to 1990, it starts to follow the theoretical curve very nicely. Probably the registration was not complete in the beginning. One thing that this doesn't take into account is the familial cases, because of course, if your parent had a retinoblastoma, then the risk is not in 1 in 16,000, it's 1 in 2. And if you have a lot of retinoblastoma families, you will get a little bit more cases than what we did here. But we think the data that I'm going to show you should be reliable. This is the original calculation from year 2009. We have Africa, Asia, Europe, Latin America, North America, and we know what's the population. And then we have to know what is the birth rate. And in some countries, like in Africa, we also need to know the infant mortality that can affect the figures. And infant mortality is not shown here, but you can see that the birth rate varies widely. That is the population and the birth rate that determine how many retinoblastomas we will have. And in 2009, it was about 7,800 per year. Now it's almost 8,000 after only 7 years more. And you see that more than half of that is in Asia, and almost half of the remaining part is in Africa. In Europe, we have to do with only about 500 retinoblastomas per year. Not much more in Latin America, and in North America, it's even a little bit less than Europe. But I have more recent figures to show you for this presentation. And if you are interested about the original paper, this is in BGO editorial, and I'm happy to say that it was of interest to people because it has now been cited about 150 times already. So I've updated this calculation to 2015 by the continent, and we start with Europe, where I come from. And the calculations, this is 2015, show that in Europe we are on a declining curve, and it's predicted to decline even further to about 400 cases by 2100. But I think this curve is now going to change because we have a lot of refugees and they have bigger families than the old have. In Europe, the mother and the father will only produce an average 1.7 children. So the population, the indigenous European population is shrinking, but this may be leveled up a little bit more quicker because of the refugee families coming to our region. And of course, this is also because the care of retinoblastoma already improved before 1950, so that basically every child who has retinoblastoma gets very quickly medical attention, and the compliance for treatment is almost 100%. And these are the 10 countries in Europe that have most retinoblastomas, and none of them has more than 100. And Russia is leading with 93, and even on the 10th place we have only 11 retinoblastomas per year. France and United Kingdom. This goes by population because the birth rate is almost exactly the same in the European countries. What about the Pan-American region where Brenda comes from? we see that until approximately year 2000 there was an increasing trend, but with improving care it is now on a slow decline, predicted based on what the population in this part of the world should be in the near future. So again, by 2100 it should be less than 800, so about double that what it is in Europe. And these are the 10 countries in the Americas that are predicted to have most cases of retinoblastoma. So we have the US leading, and then Brazil and Mexico also are about 100 cases, and that's why they are indicated in yellow. But as we know, there are now rapidly growing tertiary referral centers in South America, so the care is improving in that region of the world quickly, but they also have problems in getting the patients quickly for treatment, and they have problems in getting the families to stay with the treatment once it has begun. So the Asia Pacific is a little bit of a roller coaster. And all of these spikes here are actually based on the Chinese government that has changed the birth control policy over time. Just like in South America, we see that there was basically an increase until about 1980, and then the decline is predicted again because of improving care of children. And if we look at the whole time period, also because of the decreasing birth rate that is now catching up in other Asian countries than China as well. So there was a, yes.
So this is the incidence.
This is the incidence, yes.
So it's because the previously the children were not noted, or why is it going down now?
Yeah, this is just based on the United Nations data.
Yes, yes.
We say that the populations, and particularly the birth rates, are getting lower.
Okay.
And the main driver is not the population that's about stable, but it's the birth rate in the Asian region.
You said better care. So how will better care decrease the incidence of a particular disease? So you said the care is improving in these countries, and that's why the incidence is...
Yeah. Yeah, as I said, the birth rate is the leading change in here.
But you have to take off infant mortality too. And infant mortality will be getting less, and there'll be more survivors.
That's basically increase a little bit, but that's not very significant, particularly for the northern hemisphere.
But it is global.
Yes. And improved care is actually, by increasing the number of familial cases, perhaps increasing the incidence a little bit. But again, compared with the birth rate, that is not significant. So Brenda asked in the question, is China the country that has most retinoblastomas? Who thought that China is the country that has most retinoblastomas? And who thought that it's not true? Yeah. Most were unsure. And it's not, because India is the leading country. India is predicted to have almost 50% more than what China has. And then we have also Pakistan, Indonesia, Bangladesh and Philippines that have more than 100 cases per year. And this is because of the birth rate, as is shown here. China has a population that is much bigger than the population of India, but because there are more Indian children being born, India has way more retinoblastomas than what China has. And here are a few other Asian countries shown in the same map. And for comparison, I left here the US and Brazil from the Northern America and Mexico. and Nigeria from Africa and Russia that was the leading country in Europe. For example, we can see that there is almost the same number of retinoblastomas in US, Indonesia and Pakistan, although the populations are different size. So this is purely the effect of the birth rate between these three countries. And also the population of Russia and Nigeria is almost the same, but there is four times as many retinoblastomas in Nigeria as compared with Russia. And that takes us to Africa. And this is the curve for retinoblastomas in Africa. Currently predicted to be about 2,800 cases, and according to the world population statistic, Africa may end up having almost 4,000 retinoblastomas a year before the curve starts to level down. So they probably could do with a little bit help in getting the referral system and the treatment working. And these are the leading countries: Nigeria, Ethiopia, Democratic Republic of Congo, and Egypt. All are predicted to have more than 100 retinoblastomas a year. This is a risk that my wife took in Sudan about 25 years ago when she was working for them for a while. And this is the whole world. We are actually now living in the area where we probably have most retinoblastomas in the world, and it seems to level down and stay at around 8,000 children for the next 50 years or so. Unless something happens, the epidemic outbreak of a new virus, we've had many in the recent years, although they haven't affected these populations, or a major international conflict. But if everything goes on, if the business is as usual, then this is what the United Nations are predicting for the world. What about the future? I don't really trust the statistics 50 or 100 years forward, but we should trust them about 10 years forward. And these are the countries with most retinoblastomas 10 years from now. If it's in white, it's about the same as it is today. If it's in green, the situation is getting better. If it's in red, it's getting a little bit worse. You see that India will stay for the next 10 years at almost exactly the same as it is now. China is still on the decrease in the number of retinoblastomas, whereas Nigeria is catching up very quickly. United States is up a little bit. I think this is also because of the immigration. Indonesia and Pakistan about the same. Ethiopia and Congo coming up on the list, and Uganda is entering the list. It's not on the same list today. And Bangladesh and Brazil are going a little bit down, as is. Also Egypt as an exception to the Middle East Africa region. So that's what is ahead of you in the next 10 years. As Brenda pointed out, this was the incidence. About mortality we know very little, because there are very few papers that are reliable published about that outside the Americas and Europe. So this is a very, very, very crude estimate. For example, for most of the Asian countries, there are no publications about the mortality of retinoblastoma at all. But we know for sure that in Europe and Japan, the mortality is certainly not more than 5%. It's likely to be even a few percentage points less. And that's also for the North America. We have a little bit more mortality in Europe because of the eastern part of Europe at the moment. But the estimate for Africa is very unsure. There are people who think it's much higher than the 65%. But this is the average of the few publications that exist. And we know that in Asia, you can't really put it in one number because it differs a lot based on the country. So this is a guesstimate of the Asian mortality. But if you accept this one, then we have about 3,000 children who are dying of retinoblastoma. This is probably a conservative estimate. It's likely to be more, but how much exactly that we do not know. But we know that there is a great disparity in mortality that is shown in this slide. If we take Europe, United States, and Japan, we have about 20% of the population. But we only have about 10% of retinoblastomas and only 1% of mortality in this region. Compared with Africa, that has 15% of the population, but 27% of retinoblastomas and 45% of the mortality. Asia is around 50% in the incident, in the population incidence and mortality at the moment. So now we look in the crystal ball. If every child with retinoblastoma would be referred to a tertiary eye care center, that would immediately decrease mortality by more than 50%. And in number of those dying would drop by a whooping 1,800 to 1,200 patients per year. Only by making it possible for every family with a child with retinoblastoma to reach a tertiary care center. And in many cases undergo enucleation or whatever treatment is available. And we know that even the intra-arterial chemotherapy has now spread to more than 100 patients. And if we would have the same level of expertise and the same resources economically, and the same possibilities for the families to travel to that center, then we could decrease the mortality by almost 90%. So by 2,600 deaths a year, so that there would only be 400 per year in the whole world. We know that the transfer of skills is successful because the intra-arterial chemotherapy can be given in essentially any country. But the problem is in awareness, accessibility, and that accessibility is a big problem, and the compliance. But here I cite an Indian paper by Kumar who showed that by really investing on the compliance rate was increased so that treatment was refused by the parents initially in 71% of the cases and in only 16% at the end of the study. We need to invest not only in getting the latest treatment to the children, but also in educating the population, and I think also educating the politicians. And the numbers that I showed to you may be a very good asset for you when you negotiate with the local politicians if you don't have the cancer registry statistics. So, in summary, retinoblastoma is today the single most common intraocular cancer across all age groups in the world. We have a huge challenge to reduce the mortality from the 3,000 or 4,000 children a year. But this is possible, and of course the rewards are very high if we are successful in that. And the reason why we should be successful is that it's a rapidly growing tumor, so the symptoms are early, but the metastasis happens late. The tumor keeps inside the eye for a long period of time, and this is completely different from uveal melanoma that grows slowly. And because it grows slowly, in at least 50% of the cases, it already has sent the micrometastasis before the patient comes to us. We have highly effective treatment, as Brenda has nicely summarized already today. And if we can apply that treatment to every child with retinoblastoma, we should have less than 5% mortality. Thank you very much. Yes.
I have a question. The number you showed us about the incidence of retinoblastoma is based on their estimate with their birth rate, right?
Mm-hmm. It's based on the population, birth rate, child mortality.
So what about the genetic background?
As I told, it doesn't take into account the familial cases, because the risk of getting a retinoblastoma in the family with a previous parent is 50%. But you have to add those cases to these numbers if you have a significant number of who have familial retinoblastoma. But then I think the genetic background, because every child who gets retinoblastoma has a mutation in the eye, seems to me is exactly the same wherever you live. Yes. So probably it's background radiation from the space or something like that that affects everyone on the globe equally.
My question is, like Dr. says, maybe we have a big difference. Because we are Mongolia, you are something like that. So maybe we have a different.
There is no evidence for that. If you look at the literature, there is no paper that would convincingly show that the incidence of children born is different in any country. We have small papers, but then they are such a small population that the random variation cannot be excluded as the reason. We only will know it when China has 100% registration of all retinoblastomas, whether it is according to what is predicted by the numbers or is lower or higher. But to me, today, it should be according to these figures. There is no evidence otherwise.
And also on the genetics, everywhere where it's looked at, the types of mutations in there at the retinoblastoma gene and the proportions for unilateral or bilateral, we all have mutation. And so it's no different in any race. No other genetics seems to have an impact on the acquiring of the RB mutation.
Yes.
Sorry, I didn't catch you. Why did the Libria have an increasing number of patients?
Why is?
The Libria.
Africa. It's increasing because there are more and more children born.
Ah.
Yeah. That's the only reason. I'm sorry. For Africa. The driving force is the birth rate. So if the government, China decides that every Chinese should have 3 children, you will have 3 times as many retinoblastomas as you have now.
More and more children.
Yeah. And that will alter the United Nations prediction. They publish them every 2 or 3 years. So you need to recalculate them when the birth rate change. Okay, thank you again.